Continuing with our review, the next topics that we covered concerned bifurcation diagrams. And they're a way to see how the behavior of a dynamical system changes as a parameter is changed. And they're built up, I think it's best to think of them as being built up one parameter value at a time. So for each parameter value, make a phase line if it's a differential equation or a final state diagram for an iterated function. And you get a collection of these, and then you glue these together to make a bifurcation diagram. So here's one of the first bifurcation diagrams we looked at. This is the logistic equation with harvest. The equation is down here. And so H is the parameter that I'm changing. And H, that got cut off here. H, here's H. H is here. It goes from 0 to 100 to 200 and so on. And so a way to interpret this is, suppose you wanted to know what's going on at H is 100. Well, I would try to focus right on that value, and I can see, aha, it looks to me like there's an attracting fixed point here and a repelling fixed point there. So there are two fixed points, one of them attracting, one of them repelling, repulsive. And what's interesting about this is that, so this is the stable fixed point. This would be the stable population of the story I told involved fish in a lake or an ocean. And H is the fishing rate, how many fish you catch every year. And that increases, and as you increase H, the sort of steady state population of the fish decreases. That makes sense. But what's surprising is that when you're here and you make a tiny increase in the fishing rate, the steady state population crashes, and in fact, it disappears. The population crashes. So you have a small change in H leading to a very large qualitative change in the fish behavior. So this is an example of a bifurcation that occurs right here. It's a sudden qualitative change in the system's behavior as a parameter is varied slowly and continuously. So we looked at bifurcation diagrams for differential equations, and we saw the surprising discontinuous behavior. Then we looked at bifurcation diagrams for the logistic equation, and we saw bifurcations, say here is from period 2 to period 4. But what was really interesting about this was that there's this incredible structure to this. And we zoomed in and it looked really cool. There's period 3 windows, all sorts of complicated behavior in here. So there are many values for which the system is chaotic. The system goes from different, from period to period in a certain way. And this is it has a self-similar structure. It's very complicated, but there is some regularity to this sort of set of behavior for the logistic equation. So then we looked at the period doubling route to chaos a little bit more closely. And in particular, I define this ratio delta. It tells us how many times larger branch n is than branch n plus 1. So delta is how much larger or longer this is than that. That would be delta 1. And how much longer, how many times longer is this length than that? That would be delta 2. And we looked at the bifurcation diagrams for some different functions. And I didn't prove it, but we discussed how this quantity delta, this ratio of these lengths in the bifurcation diagram, is universal. And that means it has the same value for all functions, provided a little bit of fine print, they map an interval to itself and have a single quadratic maximum. So this value, which is believed known to be irrational and I think transcendental, is often known as Feigenbaum's constant, after one of the people who made this discovery of universality. So this is an amazing mathematical fact and points to some similarities among a broad class of mathematical systems. To me, what's even more amazing is that this has physical consequences. Physical systems show the same universality. So the period doubling route to chaos is observed in physical systems. I talked about a dripping faucet and convection rolls in fluid. And one can measure delta for these systems. It's not an easy experiment to do, but it can be done. And the results are consistent with this universal value, 4.669. And so what this tells us is that somehow these simple one-dimensional equations, we started with a logistic equation, an obviously made-up story about rabbits on an island, that it nevertheless produces a number, a prediction, that you can go out in the real physical world and conduct an experiment with something much more complicated and get that same number. So this, I think, is one of the most surprising and interesting results in dynamical systems. So then we moved from one-dimensional differential equations to two-dimensional differential equations. So now, rather than just keeping track of temperature or population, we're going to keep track of two populations, say R for rabbits and F for foxes. And we would have now a system of two coupled differential equations. The fate of the rabbits depends on rabbits and foxes, and the fate of the foxes depends on foxes and rabbits. So they're coupled, they're linked together. And one can solve these using Euler's method or things like it very almost identically to how one would for one-dimensional differential equations. And you get two solutions. You get a rabbit solution and a fox solution. And in this case, this is the Lotka-Volterra equation. They both oscillate. We have cycles in both rabbit and foxes. But then we could plot R against F. So we lose time information, but it will show us how the rabbits and the foxes are related. And if we do that, we get a picture that looks like this. Just a reminder that this curve goes in this direction. And so the foxes and rabbits are cycling around. The rabbit population increases, then the fox population increases. Rabbits decrease because the foxes are eating them. Then the foxes decrease because they're sad and hungry because there aren't rabbits around, and so on. So this is similar to the phase line for one-dimensional equations, but it's called a phase plane because it lives on a plane. And this shows how R and F are related. And phase plane and then phase space is one of the key geometric constructions, analytical tools used to visualize behavior of dynamical systems. So an important result is that there can be no chaos, no aperiodic solutions in differential in 2D differential equations. So curves cannot cross in phase space. The equations are deterministic, and that means at every point in space, and remember this is in phase space, so a point in space gives a rabbit and fox population, there's a unique direction associated with the motion, df, dt, dr, dt, that gives a direction. It tells you how the rabbits are increasing, how the foxes are increasing. If the lines, if two phase lines ever cross, like they do, say where my knuckles are meeting, then that would be a non-deterministic dynamical system. There would be two possible trajectories coming from one point. So the fact that two curves can't cross in these systems limits the behavior. They sort of literally paint themselves in as they're tracing something out tracing a curve out in phase space. So there can be stable and unstable fixed points, and orbits can tend towards infinity, of course, and there also can be limit cycles attracting cyclic behavior, and we saw an example of that. But the main thing is that there can't be aperiodic orbits. And that result is known as the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem. It's about a century old. And it's not immediately obvious. It takes some proof. Like I said, maybe that's why it's a theorem and not just an obvious statement. One could imagine, and people in the forums have been trying to imagine, space-filling curves that somehow never repeat, but also never leave a bounded area. But the Poincaré-Bendixson theorem says that those solutions somehow aren't possible. So the main result is that two-dimensional differential equations cannot be chaotic. That's not the case for three-dimensional differential equations, however. So here are the Lorentz equations. Now, again, it's a dynamical system. It's a rule that tells how something changes in time. Here, that something is x, y, and z. And I forget what parameter values I chose for sigma, rho, and beta. And we can get three solutions, x, y, and z. And these are all curves plotted as a function of time. But we could plot these in phase space, x, y, and z together. And for that system, if we do that, we get some complicated structure that loops around itself and repeats. It looks like the lines cross, but they don't. There's actually a space between them. It looks like they cross because this is a two-dimensional surface trying to plot something in 3D. All right. So just a little bit more about phase space. Determinism means that curves in phase space cannot intersect, but because the space is three-dimensional, curves can go over or under each other, and that means that there's a lot more interesting behavior that's possible. but trajectory can weave around and under and through itself in some very complicated ways. And what that means in turn is that three-dimensional differential equations can be chaotic. You can get bounded aperiodic orbits, and it has sensitive dependence as well. And then we saw that chaotic trajectories in phase space are particularly interesting and fun. They often get pulled to these things called strange attractors. So here's the Lorentz attractor for the famous values for Lorentz equations. And strange attractors, what are strange attractors? Well, they're attractors. And what that means is that nearby orbits get pulled into it. So if we have a lot of initial conditions, they all are going to get pulled onto that attractor. And so in that sense, it's stable. If you're on the attractor and somebody bumps you off a little bit, you would get pulled right back towards it. That's what it means to be stable. So it's a stable structure in phase space. But the motion on the attractor is not periodic, the way most attractors that we've seen are, or even fixed points, but the motion on the attractor is chaotic. So once you're on the attractor, orbits are aperiodic and have sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So it's an attracting, chaotic attractor. Then we looked at this a little bit more geometrically, and I argued that the key ingredients to make a strange attractor, or to make chaos of any sort actually, is stretching and folding. So you need some stretching to pull nearby orbits apart. And the analogy I discussed was kneading dough. So when you knead dough, you stretch it, that pulls things apart, and then you fold it back on itself. So the folding keeps orbits bounded. It takes far apart orbits and moves them closer together. But stretching pulls nearby orbits apart, and that's what leads to the butterfly effect or sensitive dependence. Now, stretching and folding, it's maybe relatively easy to picture in three-dimensional space, either a space of actual dough on a breadboard or a phase space, but it occurs in one-dimensional maps as well. The logistic equation stretches and folds. And this can explain how one-dimensional maps, iterated functions, can capture some of the features of these higher dimensional systems. And it begins to explain also how these higher dimensional systems, convection rolls, drooping faucets, can be captured by one-dimensional functions like the logistic equation in this universal parameter 4.669. So in any event, stretching and folding are the key ingredients for a chaotic dynamical system. So strange attractors once more, they're these complex structures that arise from simple dynamical systems. A reminder that we looked at three examples, the Ahnon map, the Ahnon attractor, which is a two-dimensional iterated function, and then two different sets of coupled differential equations in three dimensions, the famous Lorentz equations, and also the slightly less famous but equally beautiful Russler equations. Again, the motion on the attractor is chaotic, but all orbits get pulled to the attractor. And so strange attractors combine elements of order and disorder. That's one of the key themes of the course. The motion on the attractor is locally unstable. Nearby orbits are getting pulled apart, but globally it's stable. One has these stable structures, the same Lorentz attractor appears all the time. If you're on the attractor, you get pushed off it, you get pulled right back in. All right, and the last topic we covered in Unit 9 was pattern formation. So we've seen throughout the course in the first 8 units that dynamical systems are capable of chaos. That was one of the main results, unpredictable aperiodic behavior. But there's a lot more to dynamical systems than chaos. They can produce patterns, structure, organization, complexity, and so on. And we looked at just one example of a pattern-forming system. There are many, many ones to choose from. But we looked at reaction-diffusion systems. So there we have two chemicals that react and diffuse. And diffusion, that's just the random spreading out of molecules in space. Diffusion tends to smooth out differences, makes everything as boring and bland as possible. But if we have two different chemicals that react in a certain way, it's possible to get stable spatial structures even in the presence of diffusion. Here are these equations. I described them in the last unit. This is deterministic, just like the dynamical systems we've studied before, and it's spatially extended, because now U and V are functions not just of T, but of X and Y. So these become partial differential equations. Crucially, the rule is local. So the value of U or the value of V, those are chemical concentrations, depend on some function of the current values at that location and on this Laplacian derivative at that location. So we have a local rule in that it, the chemical concentration here doesn't know directly what the chemical concentration is here. It's just doing its own thing at its own local location. And nevertheless, it produces these large-scale structures. So just one quick example. We experimented with the reaction-diffusion equations at the Experimentarium Digitale site. Here's an example that we saw emerging from random initial conditions, these stable spots appear. And then we also looked at a video from Stephen Morris at Toronto, where two fluids are poured into this petri dish, and like magic, these patterns start to emerge out of them. So Belousov-Zabotinsky is another example of a reaction diffusion system. So pattern formation is a giant subject. It could be probably a course in and of itself. The main point I want to make is that there's more to dynamical systems than just chaos or unpredictability or irregularity. Simple, spatially extended dynamical systems with local rules are capable of producing stable, global patterns and structures. So there's a lot more to the study of chaos than chaos. Simple dynamical systems can produce complexity and all sorts of interesting emergent structures and phenomena.